This is a HeadGum Original.
In 1977, NASA sent two solid gold records into space so that aliens might find them and understand life on Earth.
I send greetings on behalf of the people of our planet
and friendly wishes to all who may encounter this voyager.
Now, we're making new records with our friends.
Bonjour tout le monde.
Konnichiwa.
Hola y saludos a todos.
Assalamu alaikum.
We step out of our solar system into the universe seeking only peace and friendship. We know full well that our planet and all its inhabitants are but a small part of this immense universe that surrounds us.
Hello from the children of planet Earth.
Stop.
I'm bleeding from the eyes. I break doing well-well-wells. Well.
Stop it.
Shelby.
Charlie.
Joelle Wolstein.
Charlie. Jarnel Dardum.
Huh. Okay. So,
forgot your name.
What's up, dude?
You know, a little bit of this, a little bit of that.
A little bit of Sandra.
What I need.
What I need. A little bit of you. Make me a.
Yeah!
Yeah!
Hey, Casey. Sorry for what you got to do to that audio, but.
Shelby, how are you for real? Let's be. Can we just. Stop. Hold on. First of all,
cut.
Can
cut
we just
the
be serious cut for once on this fucking podcast? God, for once, can we be serious? How are you, dude?
You know, good. I'm good. How are you?
I'm kidding. I don't want you to be real. I'm good. Things are good.
I'm good. How are you? God,
I'm good.
God, I'm good.
Oh my God. I am so good. How
God,
have you been?
I'm good. God, I'm good.
I'm fucking good too, is the crazy part.
Fuck.
Like, I'm really good. You know, a lot of times you'll talk to someone and they'll be like, how are you? And you'll be like, good. And it's like, oh, you could be good or bad. But I'm telling you right now,
I'm good.
Like, I'm legitimately, like, I'm good right now.
I feel like you part believe me, but you don't know, like, you don't even know how hard to believe me because I can't sell it to you in the right way.
Right.
I'm good.
Like, it's like people ask all the time. Like, I would say like a dozen times a day, someone's probably like, oh, how are you? And you do like the obligatory, like, oh, I'm good. How are you? But like, I'm telling you right now, when I told you I'm good,
I'm doing good.
Like, things are good. Like, professionally, great.
Personally great.
Everything is great. I'm great.
I'm doing good.
I wouldn't change. I wouldn't change anything because everything's good.
If I like had the opportunity, if someone were like, if a wizard, like literally, if I rubbed a lamp right now, okay, if I were to go, if I found a lamp and I in an attic, and I rubbed it, and when
I'll
I rubbed it,
genie.
A genie came out, and he gave me three wishes. I wouldn't even wish for things to be different because like they're good.
That's awesome. I'm tired of Airbnb hosts, though, I will say. That's the only thing that has been on my mind
lately.
What'd
they do to you?
Well, I stayed in an Airbnb recently, and on the Airbnb listing, it said two levels, right? It's a two-story house. We got the first floor. You walk in on that floor. You got the next floor. There's bedrooms up there, a bathroom. These are the things you expect. Two-story house. Well, imagine my surprise when we get in there, and there's a third story. And we go up there because it's open to us. No. It's not locked or anything.
I want you to know right now, in my heart of hearts, I feel like there was a body.
Mm-hmm. Well, in a way, you're correct. We go up there and there are uncontained birds. Now, ask me, Shelby, go ahead and ask me if there were any mention of birds in the listing.
hey, Caleb, I was...
There were not. So we go up there and there are birds flying around the third floor of the Airbnb. Okay? So I have to know that there are birds in the house. They wake us up. They chirp, 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 chirp. They wake us up in the mornings. Then on my way out, they ask me to...
feed them.
To sweep... They asked me to sweep, feed them, do the dishes, and take out the trash. Now, mind you, I paid probably a $200 or $300 cleaning fee, and I'm being asked to sweep. Unfucking believable. Have I talked about this to you before?
No. And also, birds, I know you're saying like they woke us up, whatever, but you're being gentle, at least with birds that my mom once adopted a bird, and that bird it slept right next to my bedroom door. It lived right near my bedroom door, and I didn't sleep for 6 years until we gave the bird away because that bird had a lot to say. That bird was ultimately a comedian, one of the funniest I've ever seen perform. And
that's tough to hear. but proceed.
The bird had picked up on us. The bird talked. It was a talking bird. Military macaw for all those bird heads out there. And she used to hear us like yelling at my brother and she started doing it. So, and she was like really good at it to where it like seemed like it was a person. So she would yell at him and my brother would sometimes just be like, what? And it would just be the bird. So.
Well, that can be so powerful.
Birds suck.
Birds are not good animals.
They're
they shouldn't
scary
probably
in a really
exist.
Big way.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah, I didn't know who was doing this.
I want to show you a song that I haven't been
I
able to stop listening to for a
couple days. I saw you post this and I started listening to it on my own because you shared it and I really like it, but I want you to play
it
for
the
podcast. And we'll sort of just vibe.
Oh, God.
It's not playing for me right now, unfortunately.
You can't hear it?
No, I can't.
Wow, I was really going for it. That's too bad.
I know, and it does work, but I don't know how to do it because Anya had done it.
Why can't you hear it?
Whoa, okay,
Anya,
check
will you play
this
a song?
Out. Check out how far we're going.
Anya, will you play a song for us?
Yes!
I don't want any of this cut. I want the listeners to know the journey that we went on. Kidding.
Guys.
I mean, if we have to cut it.
Guys.
Kidding. I'm not passionate.
Guys, podcasts.
Oh, my God. I want to play Adult Movies by Litany. And Shelby, did you say you did like it or no?
I loved it. I love Litany.
It's... Listen to this. Listen to this. Here goes Anya. Thank you, Anya. We got so drunk. Let me give you a haircut. Got real high on a balcony. So true. Okay, keep going. Mm. Right. Okay, so this song I have been listening to. Let me please follow me back on Instagram. I love your music, Queen. This song is so good.
Let me fucking bangs.
Wait. Knock you out with the kind of love, hate. Right. It's always the quiet ones. Right. I hate. Right. So true. Yeah. This is good. Litany, if you're out there, queen.
Litany, come
royalty,
on the pod.
I don't know your pronouns. Litany, come on the pod and follow me back on Insta, babe.
This is embarrassing, Caleb. Stop begging.
Anya, you can stop it. I never do that. Why am I like begging Litany to follow me on Insta?
Bedroom is a banger. My Dude is a banger. Adult Movies,
my
a banger.
My Dude goes fucking bananas, dude.
My Dude is one of the better songs.
Can we play that, Anya? This is the Litany hour.
This is lit. Hey guys, thanks for listening to this radio.
It's Puss in the Boob.
It's Puss in the Boob. Up next, we've got My Dude by Litany.
Litany. This shit goes, right. I feel like I want to be roller skating right now.
Yes, and not blading, skating.
She lives round. the corner, a place, and she drives her dad's Mercedes. Whitney, you went crazy with this one. Follow me on Instagram.
Here we fucking go.
And now that I really love you, and if you love me too, I can be your girlfriend.
You can be my dude.
Anya, cut it, please. Wow.
Not getting Litany. The due. Not getting her due, Litany.
Litany, not listen, I will say, Litany just got, I think, just got a million streams on adult movies. Congratulations, Litany. Also, we're friends with some musicians. I don't want you guys to think that we're friends with Litany. I don't want you to think that until it's true and I'm working on it. We stan Litany.
We really
in
do.
This friendship on this podcast.
Caleb and I used to go on peak pandemic. Caleb and I were going on a lot of night drives through Los Angeles. Those were really big. Adult movies never made the cut. I don't know if it was it out.
Might have not been out yet. I don't know.
And
I don't think so.
We were doing a lot of that, and those songs were sort of highlights of the playlist.
Were they ever?
So when Caleb says it's a big part of our friendship, he's not exactly lying.
Shelby, I have to confess something to you.
What is it?
I struggled with whether or not to tell you this. The other day, I posted something on Instagram that had nothing to do with you, which is already insulting, I understand.
Yeah, I get it. Yeah. Thank you for admitting it, at least.
One of our little freaks, a Keeping Records stan, commented and said, "Are you and Shelby still close?" I deleted the comment. So if you're listening, I deleted your comment. But there seems to be maybe a misconception that because we no longer live together.
For those not watching the video episode, my mouth is ajar.
Agape. Completely agape. Aghast. There seems to be a conception that because we no longer live together, maybe we're not still hooking up. Maybe we're not still so close that it's concerning to people around us. But I wanted to give you an opportunity to speak on that.
Guys. Well, first I want to start with, even Jeff was like, "Are you guys really not living together because of the cat?" And I was like, genuinely, yes. Yeah, in a big way.
Also, I moved in with 5 people to pay cheaper rent. You would never do that. Even if the cat wasn't an issue, you would never do that.
Yeah, I don't want to live with 5 people. It would have had to be that Caleb and I lived somewhere worse so that we could live cheaper, which... you know, was maybe a possibility, but then there's also the do they take cat, blah, 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 blah. Details, details, details. Caleb and I are as close now as we've ever been.
We hook up more than we ever even did before.
You know when divorced people, or not divorced people, God forbid, when married people are like, we have never been closer than when we started sleeping in twin beds?
Yeah.
This is our twin beds.
This is our twin beds. Let me tell you something right here and right now. Keeping Records has entered our twin bed era.
We are in our twin bed era.
And you guys are living amidst it. We are in our twin bed bags, honey.
And we are, I'm snoozing the alarm, you know?
I'm sleeping in because finally, being awake is more exciting than my dreams.
Exactly. Finally. Because I'm good. Saying exactly. I'm doing no good. Sense.
I'm good, dude. I'm literally good is the thing.
Fuck off. I'm doing good.
Everyone fuck off if you think I'm not doing good. You're crazy for that one.
Should we?
I'm so excited for our guest today.
I was going to say, should we bring her in? Or?
Guys, our guest today is a Hollywood actress and filmmaker and an amateur pop culture oracle.
She's in the new HBO show Winning Time, premiering in March. And she has an Audible original called Zaddy, which she wrote
Zaddy?
And is performing. And she recorded literally some
May?
Of it today, coming out in May.
You guys, our very dear friend, one of the people we're closest with in the world.
On the planet.
Who we met today on the podcast. Our friend, please make some noise and put your fins together for
Sarah Ramos.
I will tell you both honestly, getting caught with my pants down, I hate when that happens because it's like, how mortifying. They should be up.
I actually kind of tried to make a decision like, yeah, like it's scary if you're in a public bathroom and somebody's going to walk in. It's like, no. But I think actually the way to do it is to like be like, okay, yep, hey, I'm in here, and not like try to stop the door from opening, not be like, oh, no. Just be like, this is happening and
I'm here with my pants down.
I accept
that. And now you're
that.
The fool. If you react with confidence at that time, they're the fool.
Exactly.
You actually come out heavily on top.
I also feel that way about gossip. I don't, you know, want to be tested on this, but I, you know, you want to be like, oh, I don't want any, I hope nobody's saying anything about me. I hope my secret isn't shared or whatever. But I kind of want to be like,
yeah,
you know what? It's, maybe they'll share it. And what do I have to hide?
What do I have to hide? I also, while you were saying that, Sarah, it made me think, I think that both of you will love this story, this little factoid. A couple weeks ago, I was hooking up with this guy and I had to get up to get undressed. You know, when you're having sex, sometimes you have to get naked. And I had to get up to like take off. I had a complicated kind of sweater situation going on. And I thought it would be funny. I thought it would be kind of funny when I got undressed to go, so what do you think? And he goes, and so I'm sitting there naked. And I go, so what do you think? And he goes, awesome. And I was like, okay, forget it. Let's just move on.
You said, forget it. Put your clothes back on. You wear a turtleneck.
Forget.
How did you acknowledge that your joke bombed?
Well, first of all, thank you for calling it what it is, a bomb.
I'm not saying it wasn't funny, but he didn't get it.
He was an audience of one and he didn't like it. That's a bomb,
he
honey.
Was caught with his pants down.
Was he ever? And I said, I literally just said, he said, awesome. And I said, oh, forget it. Let's move on. And then we just kind of, you know, hooked up. But pretty funny, I think, of me to do that, to
you
present
would.
My body,
I
my naked body.
I think I wouldn't have been able to have sex after
if
that.
If he had gotten the joke, it would be like marriage material.
Yeah. Oh, that would have been so much hotter. Wouldn't that have been so much hotter?
That would have been like a big deal.
It would, you know what would have been the hottest to me is if he was like, this is really psychotic.
I was going
to
ask, what would your ideal response be? So I, yeah.
This is really psychotic. But if I had presented my naked body to this guy, who I did not know, and said, so what do you think? And he said, I've seen better. I think that'd be so hot and so funny.
Because you would have had the same sense of humor.
Yeah, that's funny because it's like we're already here having sex. Why would you say that? I think that's so funny. That's what I would have said if someone did that to me.
And if
anyway,
someone said
Sarah,
that to me,
you?
It would really do a number. It would do its little number.
Do a number?
On me.
Said, yeah. I've seen better, just
yeah.
Unprompted.
I've seen
I
better.
Was, if I had just stripped naked
and
someone
and they go,
said,
I've seen better.
You yeah. would. Extra
it's
therapy.
A dicey line with girls and gays, because girls and gays, we all have our body stuff, so you never know who's willing to joke about what, right?
There's a full like scene in a Nicole Holofcener Center movie, Lovely and Amazing, where Emily, what's her last name? Couldn't tell you. She's famous.
That's
Emily
okay.
Mortimer?
Dickinson.
Mortimer, I think.
Mortimer,
gets
okay.
completely naked in the movie. And says, like, tell me what's wrong with me to this guy. And like he doesn't.
Oh my God, is it horrifying?
It's like so cringy and awkward, yeah. I don't remember anything
God.
He says, I just remember the prompt. It's very similar to your situation.
Sarah, that made my tummy hurt.
That's cinema. That's what cinema does.
Cinema, baby!
Good film art makes you feel. Mm.
Exactly.
In its purest form.
Oh God. What is the accent you're doing, Shelb?
Intelligent.
Will hurt you. Intelligent accent from the intelligentsia region in Silver Lake.
Yeah, from the region of intelligentsia in Frogtown.
From the intelligentsia Silver Lake area. I have to ask, Sarah, how are you? Where are you? What's going on?
I am well. I'm in my home office. I've been doing a lot of voiceover work today as I just recorded the audio. Actually, I don't know I'm new to voiceover work, even though I'm very much doing it. And so I don't know the terminology, but I just recorded Chris Messina. You know that actor?
Ooh, yes.
Yes. He's hot. You might call him a zaddy, maybe. Well, I hope you would, because he is playing a character named Zaddy in my Audible original called Zaddy.
I never figured out how to do the audio effects, but I would have done a ba-dum chick when you said Zaddy, but I can't because I don't know how. So know that Shelby, I would have done it.
That's pretty famously an audio effect that you can do a cappella. You just go, ba-dum.
Yeah, but there's audio effects.
You opted not to.
No, but by the riverside, there are audio effects.
I was born. I had the strangest urge to go ahead and jump into song for you both.
Were you about to do?
Thank you.
The Wiz.
I was born, but no.
By the river, yeah.
Isn't it?
Yes,
got it. I thought you were doing.
Another thing about how I am is I'm shocked. Mm-hmm. I was a little shocked that there's a video component to this podcast. Just because I do so much voiceover work, as I just mentioned. Just kidding. But because my bangs are overgrown right now and they need to be cut. And they had to be seriously
tamed.
I think
you look stunning for what it's worth.
Thank you so much. I was fishing.
Caleb wants me to address on this while we're talking about the video component. Last week, Caleb filmed in studio and the lighting was bad. And it was not because he looked bad, and it was because the lighting looked bad. And Caleb himself, he wants me to say this, he's holding me hostage, looked gorgeous.
Absolutely.
It's time to face facts. Last week on the video, and this is not going to happen this week, Sarah. You look beautiful. We look beautiful. I am a 10. And last week's video did not demonstrate that. Last week's video, I looked like a gremlin. I looked 15 years older than I am. I'm 19, so I looked 15 years older than 19, 34. I looked bad, and it was all because of the overhead lighting. I am not somebody who looks that way. And so I want the listeners to know, of which we have millions, I am somebody who's hot, and you guys have seen me do that before. So don't think that last week is a new era for me. It's not.
I get that. And I'm glad that this is the kind of podcast where you don't like let things like that go. You like address insecurities and errors right off the bat.
Yeah. I mean, it was an error.
Exactly.
Sarah, do you consider yourself to be, and this is one of this, you know, this podcast, we podcast on such a high level here that we're not afraid to go in between silly little observations
big
questions. Do you consider yourself, Sarah, someone who lets things go?
Absolutely not. I mean, I try. I have to learn. That's my journey on this earth, is learning to let things go.
Oh, what about you? Wow. And do you think you're getting better? No. Grudge holding. Evil, evil, evil. I'm an evil, evil, evil grudge holder.
Shelby?
I have one against Shelby. Shelby, what do you think about yourself?
I don't believe, I don't let things go, and I don't believe it's my journey to learn how to. I think my journey is to continue on this path and see and let people do the correcting. You know, they have to figure it out. I should just keep on keeping on, you know?
Yes. I personally feel have to let it go. It's not working.
If you didn't grow during COVID, the original lockdown OG part one, the one where we kind of pretended to do a lockdown, I think if you didn't grow during that, you're not supposed to. And I didn't. And so I don't think I don't think the rest of my life I will be growing. I think growth is out of the option for me.
Yeah.
Is that That's bad?
Good to know yourself.
No, I think it's
so
you
sad.
Know that about yourself.
That's good to know about yourself. That was so diplomatic. You could be a politician if you wanted.
Thank you so
okay.
much.
Okay. New career alert.
Uh-oh.
Wait. Before we get into your record, Sarah, I have to ask, if you had to run for one political office, what would it be?
The president.
Just kidding.
Obviously. I'm just kidding. That's just the first thing that came to mind. I don't know.
It is the easiest one to come to, you know?
Exactly. Yeah.
It's like, the first, you have to work your way down from president. You're like political office president. Who's below that? You have to really do a whole tree, and you got to do that quick.
Yeah.
You know what's crazy? The mayor of Los Angeles serves more people, is supposed to serve, but don't let me get started, serves as an office more people than many small nations. Isn't that crazy?
Caleb, what is this podcast?
It came to my mind. I thought, well, this is a podcast where I can be myself. And I thought that was kind of interesting. I read that the other day.
I thought that was beautiful. Thank you for sharing it.
Thank you, Sarah. What is the first thing that you would put on your golden records?
Okay, well, anyone who knows me simply knows that this will be there. It's, of course, Taylor Swift's entire discography.
Oh, okay. My God. Yes.
Have you had any Swifties on the pod previously?
I think we've had Swifties, but they've not added her, which would sort of revoke their title, Swiftie status. Right?
Yes.
Okay, I'm not the authority. That's you. That's on that the just Swiftie coalition.
I mean, if you're a Swiftie, how are you not sending, you don't want the aliens to know about Taylor? Sorry, I'm not clear on what the point of the records are. Is it to communicate with aliens? Is it
so,
to...
Yeah. The original records were sent to space with the intent that if aliens ever found them, they would understand what life on Earth was like.
Mm-hmm.
So that was that's the point of them. They're also going to outlive us. So
it's not like a sort of a bummer to talk about for us.
It can be both.
Basically, I think the most important thing in building a record, and I think you've done it. We've looked over your stuff, and I think you've done this with yours. But I think the most important thing with the record is telling the aliens, okay, from Sarah's perspective, this is what it means to be a human. These things, like Taylor's music and the other things you're going to add, are this is my experience as a human on Earth, and I want to share it with you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, absolutely. Yes, Taylor Swift's entire discography.
When I think of Taylor, I think of being in my hometown and listening to Mean, specifically 2010 Live at the VMAs Mean. I felt so powerful listening to that song. Sarah, when you think of Taylor, is there a moment or a song that you think of first?
It's tough. As you see, I've mentioned her entire discography.
Yeah, you got a lot to pick from.
Putting all of that up there. One of my favorites is the album Red, which you may know has recently made a resurgence, a comeback on the scene with Taylor's version. Love that. I love all of them. I have such a sad answer. Shelby, do you have any... any thoughts? Help me
not
get there.
Not at all. Red was such a moment. No, Red was such
Red was
a moment.
Here's the true, the first, I know exactly when I first knew of Taylor Swift because it was our song.
Mm-hmm.
And I was at Jewish summer camp and a girl sang our song at the talent show and sort of didn't directly say it, but sort of passed it off as if she had written it.
Wow.
And I was kind of like, this song bangs. Like, she is talent. And then I got home and was like, no, wait a second. And it really sort of shocked me that it was not this girl. I thought it was a song about summer camp, her talking to her bunk. And it was so, I couldn't have been more wrong.
Wow.
So that was... a brutal sort of come to truth moment when I arrived, when I touched back on anti-camp land.
When you heard the song on the radio and you were like,
yeah,
wait a second.
I was like, well, first I was like, Natasha? I was like, they were like, Taylor Swift. And I was like, oh my God, I have encountered a liar.
Do you remember the person, Natasha Schmishmishmina?
I do.
Have you checked in on what she's up to recently?
Married kids.
Any new scams?
I don't know. I should check. I'll call. Maybe. I'll say, hey, you running any more lies?
Are you running any more lies? That is the big question for everyone that you're out of touch with. Sarah, I feel that Taylor has gone through. I feel that Taylor was. Okay, this is what. Okay, Taylor comes onto the scene, country. She's doing. She does. When you think Tim McGraw, hope you think of me, right? She's just in the country sphere. I feel that the general zeitgeist is ignoring her. Then she does her pop crossover. She gets big. She's beloved for a moment, but only for a moment, probably for many reasons. I do think misogyny is one of the biggest ones, but of course, that's more for y'all to speak on than me. Then she's hated.
No,
right?
You tell
I think
us.
People are hating on Taylor. Well, I do want to do that, but I know that the listeners wouldn't like it. I'm like, here's misogyny. What? No. Then she's hated. I think people are back to loving Taylor. Do you agree?
Absolutely. Taylor is like the entire music industry right now. Like she's releasing, re-releasing all of her albums to own them and make money off of them.
And
we're all buying them and they're selling. Yeah. More than other people's new music. That's insane.
Yeah. And yeah, I'll say it on the podcast. Fuck. And bleep his name. No free clout for the girly.
Fuck that music producer that you just named, whose name will be bleeped. And I do think Dovetail, which has been happening for a long time, but people are now really starting to understand, and we can bleep that name as well. No free clout for the girlies. It really helped with Taylor's reascension into a zeitgeist moment where she's not the butt of so many jokes. People are being nicer to her now because he had his comeuppance. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it goes
when,
like
when
this
he
because
was
of
still
their feud.
It, like when people were like, no, he's it.
Ugh,
he had too
that.
Many people being like, well, if he's it, then she has to be shit, you know? And
wow.
When it started to come, come to the,
did you just did the you make it, that so, up?
Sorry, I the it versus shit dichotomy of a public feud. We have to talk about that.
Do you guys think that was good?
I liked it.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, you saw a very
like
similar thing going on.
You could have stolen.
No,
2016 primaries. You saw something very similar with Bernie and Hillary. I will say.
But truly, as soon as we were like, wait. Maybe he's shit. We were like, wait, she's it. And it was a
wow,
sort of a collective.
We're idiots. We're yeah. So stupid. Yeah.
Yeah. Everyone.
Remove
I
the
do
show.
Think anyone that was team is sort of now being like, fuck. Fuck. Okay. Fuck.
They're playing the fool.
Well,
yes.
It was it or was it? And as we see, you know, on the trending topics on Twitter every day, he's getting the shit side of her it right now.
Yeah.
She's
oh
running circles around him. Kim
she's
is
running
Sarah.
A mastermind.
Circles. Well,
what did
Sarah,
he expect?
Yes.
The Kardashian Jenner
yes.
conglomerate.
This is the truth.
Jenner conglomerate.
Yes, Sarah, right, exactly.
Are some of the smartest people on earth. And they have passed themselves off as being some of the dumbest. And that is how they continue to win.
They're media masterminds, absolutely.
I actually don't think anyone is better at business than Kris Jenner. I think she's the smartest businesswoman on the planet.
I think that if you gave me a BBL, $200,000, and two kids, I could build something better than what Kris Jenner has within 2 years.
No, you couldn't.
Years.
No, you couldn't.
Within 2 years.
Within 2 years.
Within 2 years.
Billionaire mindset. Hey, billionaire mindset,
right now.
But no.
Hey, look, folks. Give me $200,000, a BBL, a couple of kids, and on the south side of 2 years, I will have an empire bigger than the Kardashians. Who's
it's
willing to invest?
It's a billionaire mindset, and I give you that. But it's a failed one. It's a billionaire
Sarah,
mindset
Sarah,
that doesn't
Sarah
take
doesn't
off.
Believe. Sarah doesn't
you're
believe
just,
in me at all.
You're just saying things, and it's just not possible. Like, Kris Jenner couldn't have done that in that long.
Yeah, and Kris
exactly.
Jenner is
you're
Kris
so right.
Jenner.
You're so right, but maybe I could. No, you're right. I couldn't.
Did Kris Jenner ever have a podcast?
No, because she's not thinking. I'm playing three-dimensional chess. She's playing checkers. She doesn't understand that having a comedy podcast it can be so powerful.
Yeah.
To be a mother and make that motherhood is a job, as we know. But to make that family into a working company is one of the craziest things you could do in a positive way. I'm praising.
They're
I'm giving
media
praise.
Masterminds. I can't even fathom the way that they control information and cultivate interest and, you know, sexually entice the world to pay attention to them. Also, well, the actually, never mind. Never mind.
Sarah said, Sarah heard her publicist and her lawyer in her head, and she said, allow me to stop. I'm obsessed.
And I said, Caleb, let's be honest, you would have like, you'd have a sock line, like the brother.
Yes, easily.
But like, that's, what else?
That's it!
Just
no!
A sock line.
Don't sell me so short. No, you're right. A sock line would be where I'd start.
What else are you talking about? What other lines of income?
I would do a sock line. I would do a sock line. I would do... Oh, wait. What was I just thinking of the other day? I had an incredible idea for an app. I don't remember what it was, but I had a really good idea for an app the other day. I would do that. Yeah. Yeah.
But they did an app that was literally just like pretending... Like, they did an app... They've had a few apps. Some apps are just like, hey, do you want to see more of us?
They've had many apps. The Kim Kardashian game.
Where you're like, yes. Pretend to be us.
I could do games.
Watch us pretend to be us and buy our shit.
Mm-hmm.
Brilliant.
Mm-hmm. I would make a cigarette. I would make a cigarette that smells like cigarettes, but is not cancerous and looks as cool as smoking cigarettes does. And that would be big, I think.
Hey, I have bad news for you, and it's that those super What's exist.
No.
Yeah,
no.
Like fake cigarettes that taste and smell. Yeah, big time. My mom uses some placebos regularly. Oh.
There's something wrong with them, though, I bet. They cause something.
One of them just makes a sound, so she feels like she's hearing it.
Makes a sound?
Yeah, like a... Like
it tells,
a
it
like
whispers to you. You look so cool right now.
It's
kind of
like... Like, it's like... She was doing chittering. It inside, and I was
is
like,
what are
you... Is she vaping? No, it has nothing in it.
Oh.
It's just sort of...
Vaping
the
nothing.
Act of
oh, my God. What a
in
statement.
A little tube.
Vaping She's nothing. What a statement on our culture, isn't it? I really just impressed myself. Vaping nothing. That it really speaks. That really speaks volumes, honey.
No, it's just a tube. You suck air in. You breathe air out. But it makes some sounds as if you're... So.
Wow.
I can't explain it. She buys That's some beautiful. Stuff. Like, my mom doesn't... Hey, if you're a police officer driving behind my mom, you're not close your ears. But my mom doesn't like to buckle, and she bought a
Queen.
Fake like a buckle yep. thing that she keeps in the thing so it won't beep at her.
Turns the sensors off.
God.
Yeah. Nice.
Wait, where does your mom
She's buying
live?
Placebos left and right. Cleveland.
Wow. Can we
Don't
hear more about her
Sarah.
Really quick?
Yeah, go off on Jill.
Powerful woman.
She sounds very interesting.
She is interesting. I have often referred to my mom as like very enigmatic. She doesn't make a lot of sense. Everything about her contradicts the next thing about her.
She makes total sense to me. I think she should be president. I
no,
love her.
She doesn't.
I think she's incredible. I really love her. She's my idol.
What's going on with you?
Even more importantly than all of that, idolizing your mom. Sarah, what's next on your records?
Okay, well, just to, I think I really like some songs from, I'll name drop one song. I love Invisible String. Do you know it?
Ooh.
It's from the newer album. No.
Anya, can you
play
it?
Can we
play
that, Anya? Anya, help us out, please. Wanna hear the song, please.
Did you listen
Wanna
to
hear
like
the song,
her
please?
Quarantine drops?
I listened to a little bit, yes. Invisible String, here we go.
Caleb, this is screaming you.
It's giving, yeah, this is very me. It's giving Sufjan.
Green was the color of the grass where I used to read at Centennial Park.
Mm.
I used to think I would meet somebody.
Blah! 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 Oh my God, go off.
Is there, can we skip ahead a little bit, Anya? Give us 20 seconds from now. A club remix of this would go harder than it should. Okay, we can cut that. That is, ooh, that's good. Is that a driving around song for you, Sarah? Because I could drive to that.
Yes, that entire album is a driving around album. It's downloaded to my phone.
It's downloaded to the phone, baby.
Yes, it's gorgeous.
For driving around. It's downloaded. Sarah has a phone just for driving around. It's downloaded to that one.
No, like, you know, if you get into, you know, you're driving. You get into territory, no goddamn service. Well, what you going to play? Folklore.
Whatever's downloaded.
Invisible Strings. Evermore. Invisible String. Lana, whatever. Anyways.
That's so good. I love that one.
In any case, okay, next I'm going to say RuPaul's Drag Race.
Sarah said gay rights. Sarah, would you say gay rights for us?
Gay rights.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Let's go. Gay people win again. Hugely powerful.
Sorry. Well, we need it. We need Drag Race up there.
We do. 100%. Who's your favorite queen? And you have to pick one.
Just one. Right now it's Angeria.
Amazing. Stunning.
Paris Van Michaels. All time. I can't do it. You go first.
Oh, God. I don't watch.
You don't watch? Does anybody watch?
I have seen many, but I don't religiously watch. And let me say one thing.
Wow.
I'm planning on changing that really soon. The problem was I started watching like a weekly thing with people, and then it was Bachelor, and I had never watched that. And then they changed from Bachelor to RuPaul, but then I went home to Cleveland. So I am working on getting back to LA to watch RuPaul and really get into it.
Oh, so you're in Cleveland right now?
Yes.
That's cool.
The land of many.
Home at the mom. It happens to the best of us.
So, and Caleb, you don't watch either?
You know what happened for me, and Sarah, I do not know how much you will like this answer, but I'll tell you my full truth because I feel like we are that close. I didn't get into it when my friends were getting into it because I was freshly out of the closet and I was one of those gays that was like, I'm not going to be like all the, like, I didn't want to do anything that felt like the gayest thing in the world, and drag is pretty up there. And that was, I'm way past that now, but then all my friends are so deep into it. I would have had to do seasons of catch ups, and I know you can kind of jump in anywhere, but what might please you is that Shelby and I, went to drag shows and stuff when we lived in Chicago, and we would put drag queens on our shows and stuff. So like our friend Dairy Queen, for example, is an incredible Chicago drag queen. And
shout out Dairy Queen.
Dairy Queen, great name.
Auntie Chan, great name. So I'm familiar with like the Chicago drag community, but I don't know RuPaul's Drag Race that much.
Look, fair enough. I love it.
You're so
personally
mad at me.
Oh my God, no! I feel like, you know what? I've messed up on the podcast. This is why your producer said, Sarah, give us your answers 7 days early to avoid a moment like this.
A moment like this. Thank you.
Yes.
My favorite thing is
lifetime
for a moment like this.
I voted for Kelly Clarkson every week.
Thank you.
Season of American Idol.
Massive. You contributed to our country's future by doing
Absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
The other day I had a thought, which was that show capitalized so big off of her being so successful because there was only like two other successful American Idols. And
Carrie Underwood.
And I would say Clay Aiken, who didn't win.
Who's running for Congress right now. Which is insane.
And there are other people who had like moderate success, but like
anyways.
Not
idols. Moving right along. Keeping it absolutely moving.
Well, Kelly was like a really big winner right out the gate. She was like absolutely a star, kind of like best case scenario. She's still a star. She still runs the culture. Like, that's a big
She's
win
a
for
show.
American Idol.
That's what
Her
I'm saying. And
amazing.
I think they got seasons on seasons on seasons chasing another Kelly. And they didn't quite get there as off. They're not batting 100, you know? They're batting way lower than that. I don't actually know. I know batting 100 means really good, but I actually don't know what batting bad would be. So I started it and then couldn't sort of lock it down at the end.
I get it. And I agree completely.
Thank you.
And without reservations.
But so
no reservations.
So Drag Race. Okay, here's something I think we can all get behind, whether or not you're a Drag Race fan. You know, are you both actors?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You're in the, I think I saw something when I was perusing your Instagram about something about Caleb getting hit by a light doing a self-tape or something.
Oh,
did
my
I make
God.
That up?
No, that
so
feels
sorry.
Like it happened.
Is that harmful?
No, Shelby, you know what it was? No. What it was I think we did a clip for the pod one week where you were helping me with the self-tape and I fell to the ground during it and smashed my head into the wall. Do you remember that?
Yes. Yeah.
So hard.
Yes.
Didn't get it, by the way. Did not book.
Well, how would you have? Yeah, no, Caleb fell as part of...
I committed
Caleb
hard.
Fell as part of a self-tape, and it was like maybe the third take of it, and the other two, he kind of phoned in the fall. Like, it was like, I'm not going to fully
And you
fall
told me as
tape.
Much. Yeah, you told me as much. You were telling me.
And you said, you need to do more.
Shelby was like, come on now.
I don't think that's true, but at the end of the day, Caleb took... the most
it was big. You can't, Sarah.
Caleb
you cannot possibly imagine.
And I
it was like that viral video, Charlotte.
Self-tape.
Charlotte takes a tumble.
Like,
was that
like,
what it was?
Are you okay? And it ruins the whole tape. So I just had to be like,
smashed my head for the next 3 days. Oh. For the next 3 days, I Ooh. Legitimately thought that I had internal brain bleeding.
Oh my goodness.
I hit my head so hard for a role that I did not book.
Did you get any?
Match.
What was the feedback?
Did not get any feedback on this one. If I had to guess, just throwing a dart at how self-tapes go, they probably cast a thin person who didn't hit their head on the wall. And yeah,
they
I really risked it all for
so
that one.
They were probably so worried that after that fall, you wouldn't be able to memorize your lines. Like you,
yeah.
The way you, I thought for sure we were going to lose. We lost our security deposit anyway, but I thought for sure we were going to lose it.
I sent the clip with the head hit as well, by the way.
Did anybody respond to be like, whoa, kind of hard, huh?
I cut the noise out, but it was the clip. It was definitely because I got what basically happened was I jumped up to fall and I cut it right after I went vertical or horizontal. And then when my body was like that, I was like, cut. But what they don't know is on the other end of that, I smashed my head so hard into the wall. But anyway, you were saying something we can all agree on about Drag Race.
Okay. So... Well, yeah, maybe actors. I don't know. But I've been acting since I was like 10 years old, done so many auditions, so many self-tapes, been driven fully insane by the experience you just described. You know, no matter how hard you hit your head or whatever, you're not even going to get a response from anybody. You don't even know. Yeah. And you're like, okay, I think maybe you lose all sense of like what you did. Were you good? Did you like... Are you a piece of shit? All this stuff. And on Drag Race, you know, I love the way that they include the queens who lose and who mess up and they turn like, let's say, okay, if you're on Drag Race and you hit your head really hard, that would become your thing, like your like gimmick. And people would love you for it and say, yes, like hit your head, baby, whatever, you know? Don't cancel me for saying that, for shouting at that enthusiastically.
Never.
Hit your head, baby.
Hit your head,
baby.
Slay. Head hitter.
Slay.
Yes,
head
hitter,
trauma.
Baby. Hit that
yes,
head.
Trauma.
Hit it harder.
Yes, head trauma. So that is like, there's no way to lose being on Drag Race. You know, even... Well, if you knew about Miss Vanjie, she was the first queen out one season and she did this bizarre walkout that made absolutely no sense where she was like, Miss Vanjie, and it was really long. She said her name like that. And she became so famous for that, came onto a new season. And I just feel like that's the way self-tape should be. You know, that's the way it should be inclusive. You know, it's not just, oh, the person who gets it gets all the attention. Everybody else gets suffocates on nothing, you know.
Everyone
it's
else like, just gets to be at home.
Yeah, for free. It's like, you know, we're a community. We're raising each other up.
Exactly.
Thoughts? And that's exactly what I feel.
we need, you're so right. We need a community around, first of all, we need jobs for bad actors. So, second of all, we need community around self-tapes. It's a horrible process. And third of all, I think that we should be doing bigger makeup for self-tapes in general.
Interesting.
And wigs.
Bigger makeup?
And wigs.
And wigs.
Like, I think every self-tape you should be doing, like, I should be doing, like, no matter what I go out for. If I go out for, like, construction worker gruff 50s, which I have been close to being sent to, you have to do
no
big,
kidding.
Full beat face 3 hours.
Well, but that's the thing. With these auditions, it's like, well, why? Nobody's even going to, we don't even know if anybody's watching it. You don't have a Michelle Visage to say, babe, your makeup doesn't look good and you need to work on your makeup, but I like your spunky personality or whatever. And it's like,
I like,
well,
your
if there's not this,
I like your je ne
if there's not
quoi.
A give and receive, exactly. Why even spend the 3 hours beating your face?
Why spend the 3 hours? You're right. But it would, I think, contribute to a culture. It would contribute to a culture.
We need more culture. We need culture around self-tapes. Yeah.
We need actor culture. You guys are right. Actor culture is
disgusting. And because it's full of shame and it's been pushed into the shadows and we need to drag it up.
And speaking of pushing to the shadows, we need to push this podcast into the shadows just for a moment so we can record our ads. Bye now, y'all.
Emails, laundry, groceries, the list goes on.
There's a lot that's on your to-do list, but what should be at the top? What should top? The answer is you. You
is
should
you.
Top.
This year, put yourself first with the help of Dipsy.
Dipsy Stories is an app full of sexy audio stories. And now they even have brand new written stories.
No matter who you're into or what turns you on, Dipsy helps bring the stories to life. Anytime,
anytime,
anywhere.
Anywhere. Close your eyes and let yourself get
lost
in a world where only good things happen and pleasure is your only priority.
Explore your fantasies in a safe, shame-free way.
Shame-free way, way, way.
There are hundreds of stories to choose from, and they release new content every week. So there's always more to explore.
They also have wellness sessions to help you wind down and explore and and sleep sessions to help you drift off.
For listeners of the show.
Dipsy is offering an extended 30-day free trial when you go to dipsystories.com/golden.
That's 30 days of full access for free when you go to dipseastories.com/golden.
That's dipseastories.com/golden. dipseastories.com/golden. GOLDEN.
You guys, this episode is brought to you by BetterHelp. Is something preventing you from achieving your goals? What interferes with your happiness? Well, check out betterhelp.com/golden.
BetterHelp will assess your needs and match you with your own licensed professional therapist. Connect in a safe and private online environment. It's so convenient. You can start communicating in under 48 hours.
Stop. It's not a crisis line. It's not self-help. It is professional counseling done securely online. And you can send a message to your counselor anytime.
You'll get timely and thoughtful responses. Plus, you can schedule weekly video or phone sessions.
There are licensed professional counselors who are specialized in depression, stress, anxiety, relationships, sleeping, trauma, anger, family conflicts, LGBT matters, grief, and self-esteem.
Anything you share is confidential, convenient, professional, affordable. That's it.
I want you guys to start living a happier life today. As a listener, you'll get 10% off your first month by visiting our sponsor, BetterHelp.com/golden.
Join over 1 million people who have taken charge of their mental health. Again, that's BetterHelp, HELP.com/golden.
Ooh.
Welcome, bark.
Welcome, bark. Sarah.
Sarah, would you give us a bark? Like a dog bark.
Ruff, ruff.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah! Yes, literally. Oh my God, we win. None of our thank guests you. Should say yes huge to that. Win. It's insane that we ask, and you were so good at it.
thank you.
We ask.
Thank you so much.
Well, Sarah, before we get into the rest of your records, which so far I'm obsessed with, which is French for obsessed, we wanted to ask you, what's something so embarrassing in all of human history that you would delete it from the records altogether?
I knew this was coming and I thought I would have something, but I simply don't at the moment. Do you?
Yeah, I think if I had to pick one just off the top of my head from today, I would probably say when you thought you were going to get up early and have kind of a slow start to the day, and then you accidentally oversleep and now your entire day is a rush, I would delete that happening. Like, I would delete oversleeping. That's what I'm trying to say.
Perfect. That actually reminded me. Okay. Yeah. I would delete social anxiety because
oh my God.
I don't like the feeling where you are excited to talk to somebody, but then, and you're like, I'm going to go talk to them. And then the being face to face in person, then the fear, and it's like, oh my God. And that cancels out the excitement. And it's just not,
it's a stressful
experience.
What is that fear? Are we worried that people aren't going to like us? Is that what that is?
That's definitely a part of it for sure.
It's got to be it, but it's also
or
like...
Or is it me?
No, it's
everyone's
definitely
like, nope,
that.
It's not that. And I'm like, no worries.
It's also, I feel like with social media and like being on the internet, it's like this is completely comfortable because we're all in our separate little squares, you know, and we're chilling in our space. But imagine face to face, it's like, oh my God, we're confronted with the reality of it. And it's like, what do I touch... I don't know.
I think there's also something to... Oh, go ahead, Shelby.
No, please take it away. Women have had enough time talking.
No,
men have
for so long dominated the discourse. Shelby, I am begging you, please, girl.
He's going to interrupt me.
No, please. But
I
just what I would say. No, you go for real.
Is this intimidating?
No, you're not scary, dude.
No worries.
You're really, really small. But you go for real. I won't interrupt you at all.
There's also the like, will people not like me? And then also, will I do something so weird that it, like, it's not just that interaction, that it becomes bigger than that. That it becomes like, damn, they tell their friends. Next time I see this person, they're like, remember that weird thing you did? And then it's something that I never escape.
Mm-hmm. But that's what brings me to the beginning of the episode, to saying, you know what? You walk in on me in a public bathroom and it's like, hello,
that's on you.
Nice to see you.
That's
and
on
it's
you.
Not, it's like you shared a piece of gossip that I trusted you with in private. Like, okay, well, what do I have to hide? It's like, what? Yeah. What's that fear?
I think too, there's a piece of it for me at least. And I think, okay. So I think there's a version of this that's like, I think there's a version of this that's relatable to everybody, but I'll say, like, you know, Shelby, you make jokes on the internet. People see your jokes. You, like, people know you have a web presence. Sarah, you're on TV and film, and you have a web presence as well. Like, I think that there's a piece of that that is like the, not to brag, everyone here. No, but I think there's a piece of that that's like, I don't want to violate your expectation. If you know me from somewhere else, if you know my comedy or my Twitter or whatever, or you know me from videos online, I don't want you to like think that I'm boring or uninteresting or too much different than that. There's like an expectancy violation. But I think even on a smaller level that has nothing to do with that, most of the time when you're meeting people, I think a lot of the times you want them to think something of you. You want them to think like, oh, they're funny or smart or hot or whatever, you know, whatever the thing is. And the fear of not being whatever you hoped that you would be to them, it can be very like... It could just be very scary. You know what I mean?
Yes. And that's why that's the number one thing I have to let go of, what others think of me. You'd be so free.
Yeah.
It would
be. Yeah, we could be so free.
that would be true freedom. There's also the like, everyone has a different like lines that they don't cross. Like, I'm pretty, I'll talk about whatever. And then I'm like, oh, I just, like, I'm sort of a chronic oversharer. And so then it's like, okay, I meet it, like, especially with newer people, it's like towing that You're line policing. And then being like, yeah. I wonder if I've crossed. And then sitting there being like, I've said something and I wonder what they're thinking of it. Still,
you gotta let it go, be set free.
Be
For
set
me,
free
it goes to
that.
An even more cellular level. In like, I'm not a very like touchy feely. I'm not like I'm a hugger and I like hug everybody. I'm like not comfortable with that actively. So it's like I struggle immediately upon being around a new person to be like with that. I guess that's just something I should work on myself with being like I don't want to hug them. I should hug them. Oh God. Do they want me to hug them? Like, I'm not making them feel comfortable. Like, this isn't a natural interaction. Like, human touch is healing. Like, shouldn't we? But no. And then it's like, I haven't said anything for like a minute.
Yeah. Well, and COVID made that worse because there's also like, there's the ask and better, actually. I think worse and better. Worse because there is like this other line that's not just personal comfort that's like, if you know someone really well and you're like, oh, we do hug, but you're like, well, now it's not do we hug? It's like, can we hug? And then there's like that. But what it also did was like, now there's sort of a more standard, like, are we going to hug? Like, there's more of a like pre-question where people are like, what are we doing? But
are we hugging? That, well, you're hugging, people, right?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. They're going in. They're like, are we doing this? And you're like,
Yeah, I'm a very touchy person. I love hugs. I'm very also like Shelby, very quick to overshare. I'll tell anyone anything about me for the most part. And COVID has made it very hard for me because now I'm like, oh God. I also have had to get better about that too because I have met so many more people in the last couple of years who are not huggers like Sarah. And so now I'm trying to be more like, can we hug?
It's not that I'm not a hugger, and I tend to, for the most part, appreciate and am desperately jealous of people who are like, I'm a hugger, like I'm so comfortable with this. It just depends on my mood and whether I'm like feeling outgoing or whether I'm feeling like frozen inside of myself.
Yeah.
Yeah. Frozen inside of myself. That is a good way to describe social anxiety, I think. Frozen inside of myself. I'm stealing it. I'm stealing it from Sarah. I'm using it all the time. I'm writing a book about it.
That Frozen Inside Myself is actually a Pixar movie that combines Frozen and what's
something called Inside Myself?
No, what's
that? It combines Frozen and then that other popular Pixar property, Inside Myself.
Inside Out?
What's Inside Out? Yeah.
It combines those two blockbuster Pixar franchises. Frozen and Inside Pixar. Myself.
Frozen is Disney, isn't it?
I don't know.
I've never seen Frozen.
Oh, thank you. Well, for when your you service. Talk about Let It Go, it makes it really feel like
let
you've
it
seen
go.
It.
Oh yeah, I'm familiar go. With that song as well.
Though. Who isn't? It really got Sarah, it really saw its moment.
Sarah, what is next on your records?
Okay. I have Sour Candy next.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you like it very sour or do you, cause it usually has a sweet core. No.
Yeah. I'll be honest, you know, I'm not obsessed with like warheads. I'm not like, you know, with hot sauce Mm-mm. people being like, how hot can it get? I'm not like, I'm trying to burn my tongue or whatever. I just prefer the sour crystals happening to just like a plain gummy worm, gummy bear. I like a little sour.
Thank you. Thank you. Mm-hmm. That's the right answer, by the way.
Thank you.
What were those things that were really popular? They were like sour, like mints, like breath mints, like sour.
Altoid
like...
sours?
Yes. Weren't those, and they're not around anymore, right?
Altoid sours?
We used to buy them at Target. Yeah.
Altoid sours were it. But
they were it, dog. IT, capital I.
I used to eat them like so much. And then my mom, I've been a vegetarian since I was 9. And my mom was like, you have to stop eating those. And I was like, why? And she told me, basically they had gelatin in it. And gelatin has like fishbone in it. And my mom was like, you've been breaking.
No, it's like horse hoof.
Yeah, there was something in there that my mom was like, you better stop.
You can have a little horse hoof.
Wow.
Have a little horse hoofs are just like toenails.
Come on, which have a little horse hoof.
Disgusting when you think that we're eating it.
I know, and it's in marshmallows too. I'm sorry, I was actually thinking of icebreaker sours.
Icebreaker sours I still
eat. Okay, yes.
Icebreaker sours I recently bought to have in my car. And what I've learned is nobody doesn't like them. Everybody wants one and nobody can have just one. People are constantly getting in my car, opening the, there's the two openings. There's the little opening and the big opening. Everyone opens the little one first, closes it, opens the big one, takes three.
Do you guys ever wonder how we learn certain things about foods? Like for example, the horse hoof or whatever. How the fuck did we figure out that we could do that? Like who was the first person to be like, who was the first person that saw like a pig and was like, I'm going to eat that? That's crazy.
I thought about that
the
other day, but not even in the context of like the grossest part of it all, but even just the basic level of being like, well, if I put eggs and milk and flour, if I grind this plant into flour and mix it with milk and eggs, cake. Like, what are you talking about? What brought you
there?
That's
crazy.
How did we get from just like foraging what we could find and like putting that in the fire to like
MSG? Like, how did we get so advanced?
I don't know. I'm trying to think.
Those people get praised.
What if Sarah did know? What if Sarah had like a really detailed answer and was like, this is basically how it happened?
I did hear a very inaccurate version of how soup was invented on a comedy podcast I listened to yesterday, where somebody said that they'd remembered that somebody was like, had a cauldron of boiling water and like a rock dropped into it. And they were like, this tastes delicious. And then they said, let's boil other things. But look, I'm just telling you what I heard on a podcast yesterday on a new podcast.
I follow this family on Instagram. I'm not proud, but I am doing it. And they recently talked about stone soup, which I think is what you're sort of referring to, which is based on an old fable. And the fable said every podcast has to talk about stone soup. Every single comedy podcast has their stone soup era.
Give me more. Go on, yeah.
We're in our stone soup era. And the fable is that these like knight soldiers came to town and like asked for food. And all the villagers were like, you literally eat with the king. Like, we need our food and we're not sharing with you. And they were like, okay, all we need then is the king. We're just going to make the king's favorite food then. And it's stone soup. And they were like, all we need is like a circular stone and we put it in the water. And then they're like, God, you know what he likes in his stone soup? And they keep just naming things. And all the villagers are so excited to learn about the king that they keep giving them vegetables until they have this like massive soup that they give to everyone and everyone eats.
Sorry, I got confused.
That's okay.
They were getting stones and then they started being given vegetables?
Sarah said, please try again, Shelby.
Is that what happened at first? Like, people saw people giving them stones and they were like, I'm going to give them a vegetable?
No, they said the king's favorite food. These are knights, okay? They know the king.
Yeah,
they're in with the king.
I got
king,
the
okay?
status issue there, yeah.
Yeah. Now that we understand status in medieval,
these guys
understand soup, you have to understand class in medieval, so.
So these are knights, and they work with the king. And the villagers are kind of like, Sarah's like, enough of the king.
And then
the king said, we just need stones
for this. Okay.
They were like, we need food, and everyone was like, no. And then they were like, okay, no worries, we'll make stone soup. And it was a farce. They were lying because they were like, all we need is a stone and some water and that'll make stone soup. It's the king's favorite meal. And people were like, okay, we'll give you some rocks. They put the rocks in the water. And then they were like, you know what the king really likes in his stone soup? Carrots. And then people were like, we can give you some carrots. And then they continued to do that until they ended up having this like gorgeous soup. And then everyone had it. They shared it with the villagers.
So the people were idiots.
The people were morons. The people did not
That's
see
the
through
moral.
A very
the people
obvious
are idiots.
Lie.
That's the moral.
And I do
the,
have to just
moral
go back.
Is the rich swindle the poor?
I have the question. Who is this quote unquote family you follow on Instagram?
Thank you, Sarah.
I am happy to give them free clout. This is Rudy Jude on Instagram. She lives in Maine. Her husband, Caleb, has seen me share some of their posts. The husband built their house by hand.
Wow.
You're following a straight couple on Instagram. Okay.
Yeah. Two kids. That's so tough. Cute. They live in rural Maine, coastal rural Maine, and they're just kind of coastal Maine, not rural Maine. Rural. Does rural inherently mean inland?
No, it does not.
Okay. So then coastal rural Maine. I just decided. And she makes all their clothes by hand and like weaves their rugs, and they're just sort of like an interesting follow. She does a lot of mending tutorials, so I watch a lot of those.
Sarah, I would love to have a breakdown of everybody that Shelby follows on Instagram, but we are just...
I actually would listen to a podcast that was just people... Talking describing who everyone who they follow.
Describing
yeah.
who they follow.
It would be humiliating.
But unfortunately, we do not have that luxury.
I didn't know it was humiliating until just now. She goes, it would be absolutely fucking humiliating.
No, not that would be humiliating. It would be humiliating for like me to be like, and this is somebody who I don't feel comfortable unfollowing after we had one exchange like 3 years ago.
We hooked up in high school.
Yeah, they're all muted. Yeah. That's what it should be. It should be interviewing people about the people they've muted on Instagram.
Oh my God, you should really do that podcast. And I'm dead ass serious. That's amazing.
Nobody would come clean. That's what it should be called.
No one
come
would say
clean.
Names. Come clean. Come clean. Who have you muted?
I'd come clean.
I'll tell you right now. I have a comedian muted. Oh, I have several comedians muted. They just won't stop issuing takes. But I have a comedian muted who I think would be very surprised to learn that they're muted. And I would never say their name.
Why did you mute them?
It's me.
They're extremely close to me. No, I had to mute them because, and I think that this is where most mutes come from. The mute function was invented to address this specific issue. I had to mute this person because they are clinically, and I would say even medically, annoying as fuck. And I couldn't keep doing it. They have bad takes and they won't stop posting.
Wow. My mutes are generally not, it's not anything wrong with the other person. It's more that they like scratch at like an insecurity I have or something.
Oh,
and I'm like, you make me think about this and I don't want to.
Mine
so
are all about the other person. Is that bad?
No, I think that's, again, that's like being a hugger. It's a positive quality.
It's a positive quality. Sarah, we are running out of time. Will you tell us what we didn't get to on your records? I know we missed a couple things.
I know, I have so many things. I'm going to do it really quick, and then you ask me something about something you think is interesting. I have social media stan accounts. I have Enlightened, the television show. Hustlers, the film, starring J-Lo. Mary-Kate and Ashley VHSs. Kim Cattrall scatting video. And edibles. Weed edibles.
Fuck.
God, and I could talk about so many of these things till the cows come home. What if I said cows come home, like, a lot?
I think you do.
I've never said it before.
Hot in Cleveland.
I can't tell you another hookup story.
Hot in Cleveland.
I said hot in Cleveland.
Oh, I am hot in Cleveland.
Okay. I want to know what are your, like, do you, I guess, I'm guessing you interact with some Taylor stan accounts.
I am obsessed with stan accounts. In the past have seen, I don't interact with the Taylor stan accounts. No, okay. I'm not engaging with them. I'm observing them. I first encountered stan accounts when I was in college and, you know, on my phone scrolling through social media, I would scroll through Taylor stan accounts and I would see some shocking information. Like I would see along those lines. One I saw, and it was like heartbreaking and also like so fascinating that you would be reaching out to a pop star. It was like, Taylor, like my mom's being evicted. Please help. Like, why, Taylor, the eviction's happening. And like just reaching out, updating about this eviction.
Not live tweeting the eviction to Taylor.
Yeah. And it was like, it's because I was like, so far deep in the hashtag, like Starlight, which is like a major, major B-side of Taylor's. And it's like, I'm like, what's going on here? And it's suddenly like, Taylor, like, we really need help with this. Like,
Taylor, please, they're taking the couch.
We're moving. Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Taylor was in her red era, but her fans were in their being evicted era. That's so sad.
Yeah.
That's so sad.
The craziest Stan accounts that I've sort of started to... The TikTok has done something globally. Mm. And these teens that are on TikTok have these Stan accounts that are also people that are like roughly their age that are just like, you're getting me through high school. And it's like, oh my God. And all these TikTokers share their Stan accounts like religiously. Like that's like a big part of it, I guess.
Mm.
And they like ask there's like a new relationship with TikToker and Stan accounts where they're like, someone make an edit of this. And then like every single fan account will be like, here's a video compilation I've made of these 6 pictures you took with your girlfriend. It's just like, nice. And then they'd share it. And that's like the whole thing. Or they'll share like a Stan account made a video and they'll be like, I love this one. And you're like, what? Why are we engaging?
TikTok is all fame, no substance, in my opinion. And it managed to really amplify that idea. So this makes sense to me that you're like massively interacting with your Stan accounts, where I think people who are famous for being, you know, talented or do substantive things like maybe like writing or acting or whatever, things that are more tangible, I should say, not substantive. I think they would be more embarrassed to interact with their Stan accounts.
Yeah, but the Stan accounts will also be like Caleb liked, or like Caleb's like four.
Which
four
I love, hosts. By the way. I'm trying to have that. If I find a Stan account of me, I'm going to interact with them every day.
Well, exactly. I think that having a Stan account is really a sign of status, you know, like the knights.
Big time.
Like the knights in the king.
The soup story.
Modern day knights are.
Oh my God.
People who have Stan accounts. Yeah. That's true. That's just the truth.
Hold on, you said some other stuff. Edibles. Do you have any like really powerful edible moments?
Well, I don't like getting too high on edibles. Who does?
Nobody.
Once when I was in high school, I got too high on a brownie and went to the circus and rode my bike home and don't remember that.
The circus is such a great place to be.
I can't go to a sober high. I can't go sober.
The circus used to like come around. I don't know. Like I'm from Southern California. I don't know about
you guys.
The circus
really fell off. Yeah.
Where's the circus? Like it used to be around.
Sorry, guys, starting a new podcast called Where's the Circus?
The circus really fell off.
Like Serial, but it's just sort of like a really deep dive into where the circus went.
Absolutely. So I have those bad experiences, but generally I like to just kind of cruise and relax on just a microdose of an edible.
Exactly.
I'm obsessed. Obsessed.
And
even.
You know what? A lot of times they come in sour candy form.
Which
I
is
have
huge
an invention.
For you.
This exactly. is how I'm going to become millionaire Kardashian business woman.
Mm-hmm.
I have had edibles that taste so good that I want the whole bag, but I can't have the whole bag because I would die.
You're going to invent snacks.
I want, no, close. You're close. I want, when you buy an edible, I want the same candy, same flavor, but placebos. And then a separate little tiny bag of the edibles so that when you have one, you can have the rest or some of the others.
You just invented snacks.
No, it's different because like there's an edible that is so good and I want the taste of it constantly. Can't have
that
it.
That seems so tricky though, because what if they look exactly like the weed ones?
But you put them in a tinier little bag. Inside the bigger bag.
Yeah, Sarah,
that is placebos.
Sarah, you're forgetting that these ones would be in a tiny bag.
You guys don't get it, but I'll tell you what.
I'll tell you what.
There's somebody who will. Sharks.
There's someone who will. I'm gonna get a level funding. So.
Yes. Good luck,
Sarah. Thank you for coming on. You've been an incredible guest.
Stunning.
I think
both
of you as somewhat of a pop culture connoisseur, so it was an honor to have you on.
My God, thank you so much. I feel seen.
Sarah, is there anything we will tell people in, or we did tell people in your intro, kind of what you're up to, but is there anything you want to plug? Do you want to tell people where to follow you?
You can follow me on social media, you know all the things. And I am really excited about my Audible original that I recorded literally today. And, you know, look, do I personally listen to fiction audiobooks? No, but I think that
should you listen to Sarah's? Yes!
Like this. So I'm excited about it. It's coming out in May. It's called Zaddy.
Exactly. Massive.
Can't wait.
Listen to Zaddy.
Everybody go listen to Zaddy. And thank you so much, Sarah. We appreciate you.
That was a HeadGum Original.